Tonight is Freedom Basics 101. And just in case you're not sure, let me clarify, this is not the Kairos event. This is the first part of four classes that are preparatory to the event. The event is a two-day experience involving prayer, worship, encounter with God, soul-searching, things of that nature. But the Freedom Basics classes are designed, I think the best way to put it is to clear away some of the clutter that would otherwise impede us from being able to receive fully what the Holy Spirit has for us. It hopefully answers many questions in advance. It should give us a better understanding about where the Kairos event will be headed. Hopefully, it will prepare our hearts in such a way that when the event arrives, we will be more prepared than had we just walked right in off the street. So tonight is the first of four classes. We'll be offering them for the next several Sundays. Tonight's class is focused on hearing God's voice. Does everyone have a handout with that title at the top? I'll take that as a yes. Let me pray for us, and we will jump right in. Father, we are grateful for your presence in our lives. The busyness of life, the distractions, the many, many things that we fill our lives with often lead us to forget that you are there. We become so preoccupied with lesser things that we forget what is the very best thing. And so I pray that tonight, at least for the next 45 minutes or so, you would grant to us a conscious awareness of your presence. Grant to us the ability to tune everything else out and be completely open and ready for whatever it is you want to say to us tonight. And we offer our prayer in the strong name of Jesus. Amen. I want to begin by, first of all, defining for you the word Kairos. It's not a word that we use in everyday language because it's not an English word. It is a Greek word. Specifically, it is a Koine Greek word, the Greek that was used in the writing of the New Testament. In Koine Greek, there are two different words for time. One of them is chronos, chronological. It refers to the passing of seconds and minutes and hours, the way we measure our days and years of our lives. The other word for time is kairos. And kairos does not so much refer to specific units or measurements of time, but rather it is a reference to a season of God's choosing, a particular season in which God plans and desires and implements a new thing. It is a special time, if you will, in the lives of individuals, in the lives of a people group, a nation. It is a time of God's choosing, a season in which he prepares to do a new thing. I think this experience that we will be moving through together is aptly named Kairos, because in this experience, God wants to do a new thing in your life. No matter where you have been, no matter what the cumulative effect of your life experiences up to this point, God is ready to do a new thing. God is more than willing to do a new thing. The only prerequisite, truth be told, is our willingness to be a part of a new thing. God is not going to come down here and get anybody in a headlock and force any of us to grow, force any of us to receive what he has for us. No, he will offer it and give us every opportunity to indicate to him, yes, this is what I want. I want you. I want whatever it is you have for me. Whatever healing, whatever restoration, whatever forgiveness, whatever, I'm here and I'm ready. And so I hope as we move through these experiences, looking toward the Kairos event itself, that will be your frame of mind, that you are coming completely open and ready for what God wants to do, ready to receive whatever it is that he has for you. Do you know what the very first recorded activity of God is? What does history tell us was the first thing that God ever actually did? He spoke. The first thing God ever did was to speak. Genesis 1:3, and God said. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the second person of the Trinity, is referred to in the Gospel of John as the Word. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Bible is God's primary means of revelation to us apart from Jesus Christ. And of all the various means that God could have used to communicate with us, being God, I'm sure any number of things are available to him, many of which have never entered our minds, he chose to write, to give us a book with words. The first thing that the Father did was speak. The Son is the Word, and the Bible, the inspired Word of God, men, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, writing down words for us to receive. I think if you add all of this together, this Trinitarian look at God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one thing we can come away with it with absolute certainty is that our God is a communicative God. God has something he wants to say. Tonight we're talking about hearing God's voice. I think the necessary starting point is to remind ourselves that God really does have something to say. I don't know that we always believe that. I don't know that we're always ready for that. But I want us to begin tonight by reminding ourselves, yes, our God is a communicating God. And is it any wonder then that you and me, men and women, who are created in the image of this God, are communicative creatures? That is one of the primary means by which we reflect the image of God, that we are able to communicate with him and with one another. We can send messages, we can receive messages. We have intentions with the message we send, and we interpret the messages we receive. That's fundamental to the nature of God. The desire, the willingness, the ability to communicate and to be communicated with. And what that tells me then, if it is so fundamental to God's nature and so fundamental to who we are as creatures created in the image of God, what that tells me is that words have power. Words have tremendous power. Now, I'm not talking about hocus pocus. I'm not talking about magic. No, I'm simply talking about the unique ability that the spoken or the written word, the unique ability those things have to impact our lives, to shape who we are, to shape who we believe ourselves to be. Words have moved entire nations. Words have changed the course of history. Words have power. Regardless of the old playground nursery rhyme, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words can never hurt me. Anyone who's ever been hurt by a word knows how false that statement can be. Words can be used for good or for ill. As we seek to hear God's voice, I want us to begin understanding not only that God has something that he wants to say, but what he wants to say is good. God is good. And every word that he has for us is good. Now, that doesn't mean that every word he has for us is going to feel good. Anybody who has been parented or is a parent understands that sometimes good words are given in such a way that they don't feel very good. But we never have to question the fundamental goodness of God as we seek to hear his voice. And I think it is vital, absolutely vital, that we cultivate this skill of hearing God's voice because of Roman numeral number one. We grow up in a world where people continually tell us who we are. Words are coming at us all the time. From the moment we are born, words are coming at us, telling us things about ourselves, telling us things about the world, about God. They may be true, they may be false, but whatever the case, the words are always coming at us, and they are shaping our view of other people, of God, and of ourselves. It starts at birth. A little baby comes into our lives, and we are immediately speaking words, hopefully of love and encouragement, seeking to elicit words in return. We want this little person to begin to learn how to communicate as well. And what a great day of celebration it is when that first word is uttered, or at least what we believe to be that first word. We spend the first months of their lives practically begging them to speak and to walk, and then the rest of their lives begging them to shut up and sit down. Words are a formative part of our lives from the very beginning, and it does not stop all throughout our lives. From birth, we move then on to school and to the playground and to the neighborhood, and we begin to hear words there, and those words can either be positive and uplifting and encouraging and truthful, or they can be incredibly painful and disabling and false. And whether they are true or false, they continue to do that shaping work in our lives, making it all the more imperative that we understand God has something he wants to say and that we can hear what he has to say. Reputations are built and destroyed by words. People's very lives are either set on a trajectory for success and wonderful things, or they are brought down as low can be because of the words of other people. One of my favorite Pastor Ken stories, if you've been around here for a while, you've probably heard him tell the story of when he was a little boy. His father, Judge Werlein, prayed with him every night, and as he would then put Ken to bed, the judge would say to him, "Kenneth, you are a good boy, and one day you are going to be a great man." I have to think that in some measure, the reason we are here in this place called Faithbridge, this dynamic, growing church, is because a vision was cast into little Kenneth's heart, a vision cast by words that he took in and he believed. And now he's living it out to the tremendous blessing of thousands of people, both here in our community and all around the world. On the other hand, I know an individual, he went with me on a mission trip a dozen or so years ago, and we were talking about that experience that Pastor Ken had as a boy. And I could see this fellow just sort of looking out the window of the airplane as we flew across the Atlantic, and rather wistfully he said to me, "You know, that isn't what I heard when I was a boy." I said, "No, what did you hear?" He said, "I heard on a pretty regular basis just how worthless I was and what a bother I was, and even how my dad wished I had not come into the world." Those words shaped that person as well. And thanks be to God, in spite of the horrible messages coming to him on a very regular basis, he has grown up by God's grace to make something of himself, but it hasn't been easy. It has been a struggle because he was already behind the eight ball due to the words that were coming into his life. Words have power, words matter. Words set our lives on a trajectory that can stay with us all the way to the grave. I learned this firsthand when several years ago I decided to enter into the adventure of church planting. About, I'm gonna say nearly 20 years ago, in the American church scene, there was this notion prevalent among pastors that really there were basically two grades of pastors. There were church planters, and then there was everybody else. And if you didn't want to be just a run-of-the-mill pastor, then by golly, you were going to be one of these fellas or gals that got out there and started something new, started something from scratch. That would really show your worth and value. I don't know that anyone ever articulated it quite as specifically as that, but if you were a pastor back in those days, it was a pretty undeniable message that was out there. And I bought into it hook, line, and sinker. I believed those words. And so I began to convince myself that I needed to be a church planter. If I wanted to live a worthwhile life, if I wanted to do great things for God, then the only path to doing that was to be a church planter. And so I set about doing it. I even went so far as to apply and get into and complete a doctoral program, a large part of which was focused on church planting. And upon graduation from that program, I moved to Atlanta, Georgia, and proceeded to plant a church. And went through the whole process of starting from scratch. It was a 5-year experience, started from scratch. No money, no people, no nothing, but by golly, we jumped in there, started out in an elementary school. We grew it to a place where we had enough people to make something happen. We bought some land, we built a building, we got in there, we celebrated, and at the end of 5 years, I was ready to leave the ministry. I was mentally, emotionally, spiritually, physically exhausted. There was no joy in my life. Oh, I had achieved the goal. I had done what the words told me that I needed to do, but there was no fulfillment and there was no sense of having achieved God's will in my life. I had simply bought into words, words which were well-intended, and I'm sure landed on many hearts in just the right way, but in my particular case, set me on a path that nearly destroyed my ministry. Thanks be to God. There were other voices that could speak into my life. And I began to realize I don't have to let the world shape me. Even if it's other Christians, even if it's other pastors. Really, there's just one voice that I need to listen to. There's just one voice out there that has my best interests in mind all the time. It was a hard lesson to learn, but a very important lesson to learn. The world will not hesitate a single minute to tell you what is true about you and about your situation, whether it's true or not. Thanks be to God. Roman numeral 2, God has an opinion in the matter as well. God has an opinion in the matter as well, in the matter of who you are. Psalm 139 tells us that he knits us together in our mother's womb and that we are fearfully and wonderfully made. In other words, not a single one of us is here by accident. Not a single one of us. We were created with intentionality, with purpose. God brought every boy and girl, every man and woman into this world for a reason. And we have value because he brought us into this world with intentionality. We have value because God has declared that we have value. And there are words that God wants to speak to us. There are things that God wants to say to us about us that will set a trajectory, not necessarily for success by the world's standards, but for a relationship, an eternal relationship that will bring meaning and purpose and hope to each one of our lives as we are able to hear and receive that word. I happen to be a fan of the Harry Potter series of books and the movies. I've read them all. I've watched them all. They're entertaining. I like to watch them with my girls. And if you know anything about those stories, you know that one of the primary characters is a mentor, a wizard, who mentors this young Harry Potter. His name is Dumbledore. Dumbledore is a very wise and capable wizard. A very wise and capable man. In one particular scene, Harry and Dumbledore are on the school grounds, the school of wizardry and magic called Hogwarts. And when you're on Hogwarts, there are certain types of magic you can practice and certain types that you cannot. And one of the things that you cannot do when you are on the grounds of Hogwarts is to do a thing called disapparating, moving from one location to another at the snap of a finger. Well, Harry and Dumbledore are standing outside talking one day, and Dumbledore decides they need to go somewhere else. And so he sticks out his arm and he says, "Harry, take my arm," indicating we're about to disapparate. And Harry says, "But Professor, I thought one was not allowed. One could not disapparate on the grounds of Hogwarts. And Dumbledore says, well, there are certain privileges that come with being me, the wisest wizard in the world. There are certain privileges that come with being God. God is able to do things and say things into our lives that other people don't have the privilege of saying. And they carry a weight, and they carry a power, and they carry an ability to change us and to give our lives meaning and purpose that other words will never, ever be able to do. I've discovered, though, that hearing God's voice, as much as he wants to say it, and as desperately as we need it, hearing God's voice is not always an easy thing to do. Sometimes it's a terribly challenging thing to do because we forget a fundamental principle of hearing God, Roman numeral 3. Hearing God is not about what we do, but who we are. I want that to sink in. It may be the most important thing you hear all night tonight. Hearing God is not about what we do, but who we are. Here's what I mean by that. Almost invariably, when we go to God, when we want to hear something from God, it has something to do with what we want to do or what we think he wants us to do. Lord, what is the next step? What is the plan? What is your will for my life? What is the path that you want me to travel? What are the actions that I should take here? How should I respond in this situation? Almost always, our desire to hear God is focused, is centered upon, God, tell me what to do. I mean, I'll do it. Just tell me what to do. But God is not first and foremost concerned with telling us what to do. His primary concern is in telling us who we are. God's primary concern is not telling us what to do. It is telling us who we are. That is why he created us human beings and not human doings. God is infinitely more concerned with who we are than what we do. And the fact of the matter is, who we are always precedes what we do. The things that we do are a reflection of who we are. If we do evil things, we're moving toward becoming an evil person. If we do godly and righteous things, it's because we are moving toward becoming a godly and a righteous person. God does not so much want to talk to you about the next thing that he wants you to do. He wants to talk to you about who you are. That was a huge, huge lesson for me in the whole church planting fiasco. God, what do you want me to do? Oh, surely you want me to plant a church. I mean, that's what all grade A pastors do, right? So that's what I am going to go do. That's what I went and did. And what I did nearly killed me. And when I was flat on my face and desperately needing to hear something from God, you know what I asked him? Lord, what is the next thing that you want me to do? And you know what I heard? Nothing. Silence. Pray as I might. Beg as I might, plead with the Almighty for some sort of instruction about what I should do. God had nothing to say because he wasn't interested in addressing what he wanted me to do. It took a little while, and it took some wiser people coming into my life to help me begin to realize Forget the doing for now, Dan. We'll get around to that one day. Right now, I want to talk to you about who you are. I was somewhere in the neighborhood of 38, 39 years old when all of that transpired. I give thanks that I was that young when that lesson finally came home, because I know men and women who've lived much, much longer lives before they ever realized how much more who they are matters to God than anything they have ever done. And I have known people who have even gone to their grave never discovering that important truth. God has something to say, and he's gonna say it, and we have the capacity to hear it, but we need to understand, first of all, God's not going to be talking to us in this experience anyway about what it is he wants to do or he wants us to do. He's going to be talking to us about who we are. Why? Because we don't really know. We've bought into 1,000 different messages that have come our way from the time we were born. You're dumb. You're smart. You're the pretty one. You're the ugly one. You're slow. You're fast. You're a good athlete. You're a terrible musician. You'll make an awful businessman. You really should be an architect. On and on and on, the voices come at us, telling us who we are. And all the while, God is doing his best to push that stuff aside and say, hey, let me talk to you for just a little bit, not about what I want you to do, but about who you are. I want you to begin to understand that you have value to me. And that gives you value, period, regardless of what the rest of the world has to say. By quieting myself before God and giving him a chance to begin to speak into my life about who I was rather than what he wanted me to do, he set my life on a path that I could have never in my wildest dreams imagined. Because I finally came to a place where I was willing to quiet myself before the living God and hear what he had to say about me, Dan Slagle, as a person, not as a pastor, but as a person. God began to unfold a story in my life never in a million years could I have written. That's been 16, 17 years ago now. And in that time, just to give you an idea of some of the things that God has done that I never imagined possible. At that point in my life, I'd only ever been out of the United States twice, once to Canada, once to Israel. Since then, I've been all over the world, I mean, literally all over the world. I've had the opportunity to speak to and minister to and share the gospel with thousands of people. I've seen things, and I've met people, and I've had relationships, and I've been able to serve God in ways that had never entered my little brain. But I am convinced, had I been so obstinate in demanding that God tell me what to do rather than taking time to hear what he had to say about who I was, none of that would have happened. Because it was only in the discovery of who I am that healing began to take place. It was only in the honest recognition of what was going on in my heart that God began to redeem and regenerate and do a new thing. Several things that we need to understand about our ability to hear God. Roman numeral 4 point A, it is innate. We are created with the capacity to hear God. That's a given from the get-go. That's simply part and parcel of being human. We have the capacity to hear from God. We have souls that are sensitive. We have eyes that can read, ears that can hear, a mind that can think and dream and see visions. We serve a communicative God, and He has created us with the ability to hear from Him. A second thing we need to understand about our ability to hear God is that it is be learned. Learned. It is something that we must cultivate. I have a friend who is an avid birder, bird photographer, as a matter of fact. Some of his photographs have even been published in National Geographic, a very accomplished individual. But he's just as happy simply looking at and listening to birds of all kinds. And back in the day when I was still playing golf, this guy and I would go out and play 18 once in a while. And it used to just amaze me as we would drive around the course. All I heard was chirping and whistling and tweeting. That's what my brain heard. His brain heard, oh, that's a sparrow. That's a robin. That's a cardinal. That's a yellow-bellied, swallow-tailed, whatever. My gosh, how do you know that? Because he had worked at it. Because he had cultivated the ability to listen and know. That's what that is, and that's what that is, and that's what that is. Just like moms have an innate ability to hear their child's voice, nevertheless, as the child grows and they become familiar with that voice, there is a period of learning that culminates on the day when their child is out on the playground with 100 others. And they're sitting there with 20 other moms, and all of them are talking at the same time, both on the playground and at the benches. And yet one little voice pipes up and says, "Mom!" Boom. And the right mom turns and looks and knows. She's cultivated that ear. We have to cultivate an ear for God. He has things that He wants to say, but we are so accustomed to listening to other voices and other sounds and other influences that we can't always be sure that what we are hearing is God. We have to work at it. Now, some Christians get really antsy when you start talking about work as related to our faith. So let me clarify something for you. Is our God a God of grace? Absolutely. Which means that we cannot earn anything. God's love, God's mercy, God's compassion, His gifts, and even His word is a gift of grace, freely given. So God is always opposed to earning, but He is never opposed to effort. And there is a big difference between the two. God is pleased with effort. God is pleased with the man or woman who leans in and indicates, I want to hear. I really want to hear. I'm going to turn down the noise of work and the noise of these sins that are tripping me up and the noise of media, and I'm going to listen to you, and I'm going to learn to distinguish between your voice and every other voice I hear. That draws God like a moth to the flame. That gets God's attention when one of His children says to Him, I want to hear what you have to say. And suddenly we find ourselves hearing and knowing that's from the Lord. That is most certainly not from the Lord. It's not magic. It's like any other relationship. And point C, it is dependent upon our willingness. In other words, our ability to hear God is capable of either maturing or atrophying. It can become sharp or it can become dull. You know, Solomon started out his life with a keen ear for God. Wisest man who ever lived, so he was called. Filled the book of Proverbs. Made many wise decisions along the way. And had he stuck with it, my goodness, the things he could have done, the truths he could have stated, but he didn't. No, he decided to marry 700 women and have 300 concubines from pagan nations, and he became enamored of the pagan gods, and he became so enamored of those pagan gods that he could no longer hear the voice of God, and he essentially died deaf to God's voice. The same principle holds true for us. We can cultivate and develop that ability to hear God, or we can kill it. And the way we kill it is by refusing to engage. The more we listen, the more we hear. I would encourage you to write that down. The more we listen, the more we hear. Now, it's just a given. Most of us do not like to listen because listening requires us to sit still. And listening means that we can't keep talking. We have to shut up and be still and give God a chance to speak. But if we are going to hear anything from God, we must cultivate that ability to listen. We've got to remove the distractions from our lives. I'll go to my grave forever thankful for my wife for a million reasons, but primary among them is, like no other person in my life, she has taught me the value of listening. In fact, I would go so far as to say she has taught me how to listen. Because for years, before I was married to Becky, I honestly thought that you could sit there with a clicker in your hand and watch TV and listen. But one day, as I'm clicking through the TV and she's talking to me, all of a sudden I hear her say, "Did you hear what I just said?" Yeah. "Well, tell me, what did I just say?" "Well, you said something about the thing that you like wanted me to do." Yes, no. As Ben Stewart has said, our wives want us to listen with our faces, to put down the clicker, to put down the magazine, to put down the whatever and pay attention. God wants the same thing. God wants our full, undivided attention. And marvel of marvels, Roman numeral number 5, God actually accommodates himself to us. Sometimes he speaks audibly, sometimes visually, sometimes emotionally, sometimes impressions, but he will do whatever he has to do to make sure we hear what he has to say. He is not a withholding God. Once I was speaking with my older brother about the nature of God, and at the conclusion of the conversation, my older brother's name is Jesse, and one of the brightest people I've ever known, he looked at me and he said, "You know, it really is difficult to discuss the ineffable without being obtuse." I thought to myself, I don't even know what you just said. How on earth am I to hear and understand what God is saying to me? But that was a needless concern of mine, because God puts the cookies on the bottom shelf. God will do whatever he has to do to get the message across. And he's fully aware, Roman numeral 6, of the obstacles that we have to hearing his voice, such as distractions, both good and bad. There are good things out there that can keep us from hearing God's voice. Ministry, doing the work of God. Parenting, marriage, all of those are good and wonderful things, but if we are so preoccupied with them, we're not going to be able to hear what God has to say. And bad things as well. Persistent sin, a stubbornness, a refusal to obey. Those things will plug our ears just as quickly. Sometimes we ask God the wrong questions. Sometimes we get it in our head that what really matters, God, is the question I'm asking you right now. I need to know this right now. And so I'm expecting that that's what you're going to say. That's what you're going to address. And we don't hear a thing because God has decided that's really not the most important thing right now. That's not what I want to talk to you about. And he waits until we come to a place of being ready and willing to ask the right question. Roman numeral 7, he uses a variety of means to speak to us. Scripture, both generally and specifically. Generally, we've got these things called the Ten Commandments. They are for everybody, for all time, everywhere. But once in a while, God has a very specific word for us, a very specific verse. In our quiet time, suddenly the words leap off the page and impress our hearts, convict our hearts, enlighten our hearts. God uses the word. God uses people who love us enough to speak the truth. I hope you all have at least one truth speaker in your life, not someone who says things that you want to hear, things that will tickle your ears, but things that will convict you. Sometimes God uses dreams and visions. In my travels around the world, I am learning that in the Muslim world, God is very actively using visions right now, dreams, to convert people to Christianity. My dear friend Peter Pereira, spoken here on a number of occasions, was telling me about a trip he made to Lucknow, India, which is a Muslim stronghold. He took his team of fellow ministers there to do some covert evangelism, doing so at the risk of their lives. And one night, they were gathered in their hotel room, praying, as a matter of fact, when suddenly there was a knock at the door, and they all looked at each other, afraid, because they weren't expecting any visitors. And when Peter asked, "Who is there?" the answer came back, "Muhammad." And they all thought to themselves, "Oh no, we've been found out. We're either going to jail or we're going to get beat up or worse." He said, "What do you want?" And Muhammad said, "We need to come in, and we need to come in now." And Peter thought, well, they're going to come in one way or the other, so we might as well just let them in. So he let them in, and Muhammad and three other men came in, all by their dress, evidently Muslims. And Muhammad said, "Which one of you is Peter?" Peter said, "I am." "What do you want?" He said, "Last night, the four of us all had the same dream. A man named Jesus came to us and told us to come to this hotel and to this room number, and there would be a man there named Peter who would tell us about Jesus. And we're here and we want to know." And four Muslims became believers that night. Yeah, God can talk to us any way that he wants to. He can use circumstances. He can box us into situations. He can give us opportunities. Sometimes he uses peace, usually after a season of wrestling and pain, so that the contrast is undeniably clear. This is the voice of God, because it's bringing peace into my soul. And F, as I said, any way he chooses. Balaam heard God's voice through a donkey, and Moses from a burning bush, and a king saw a hand writing a message of doom on the wall as Daniel the prophet stood there. God can do whatever he wants to do. The question is, do we really want to hear it? The really big problem, truth be told, in hearing God's voice, Roman numeral 8, is that God's voice isn't the only one we hear. The enemy shouts at us. Fatigue makes us weary and unwilling to hear. Sometimes we are so eager to hear one thing and one thing only that we miss what God really wants to say because we've got our own agenda. So how do we discern? How do we know that the voice we're hearing is the voice of God? Point A, is it scriptural? This is basic to everything. God's voice will never contradict his written word. Never, ever, ever. If you hear a voice and it's telling you to do something that is contradictory to the word of God, forget it. It is not God. I had a man and a woman come to me in the first church that I served long, long time ago. They made an appointment with me under false pretenses. It was ostensibly to come and talk to me about a ministry they were both involved in. When they got to my office and closed the door, it became apparent they had another agenda entirely. They then set about to convince me that it was God's will that each one of them leave their respective spouses so that they could then get married. And I guess they could tell by the incredulous look on my face that I really wasn't tracking with them. And they kept saying to me, "We just know this is God's will." And I kept saying to them, "I just know it is not." And the more they pressed, the more I resisted. And I could see their temper rising, and they were getting so angry with me that I would not bless this message from God. And finally they said, "How do you know?" And I said, "Because the Bible says, thou shalt not commit adultery." It doesn't say, "Thou shalt not commit adultery," unless you just really feel like it. And your name happens to be Steve and Donna. It does not work that way. God will never, ever contradict his word. B, is it the conviction of the Holy Spirit or the condemnation of the enemy? What's the difference between the two? Conviction, the convicting work of the Holy Spirit, always leads toward repentance, reconciliation, regeneration, moving forward in our lives. The condemnation of the enemy is always about accusation. It is stagnant. It goes nowhere. It simply tells you what an awful person you are, but does nothing to move you off center. The convicting work of the Holy Spirit keeps us moving forward. As Winston Churchill said one time, "If you find yourself going through hell, keep going." God is all about moving forward. C, do godly counselors confirm it? When Pastor Ken extended to me the invitation to come to Texas 16, 17 years ago now, I was pretty excited at the prospect. However, that night, as we were going to bed, and I casually mentioned to my wife, hey, what do you think about moving to Texas? Her response was, well, I hope you have a good time. Because there is no way I am taking my babies away from our family and our friends. We have lived right here in good old Georgia for 40 years. She said, I have honestly thought more about moving to Africa than I have to Texas. I said, well, would you at least be willing to pray about it? Yeah, I will do that. And so we did. For 18 months, we prayed about it. And over that 18-month period, God was very faithful to give us green lights almost every month in small ways. This is what I want you to do. But I did not trust myself. I just exhausted myself in a futile effort, and I did not want to do that again. So I sat down one day and I made a list of the 10 godliest men I knew. Men that I knew beyond a shadow of a doubt, loved him, served him, lived for him, walked with him. And I wrote all 10 of them a letter, a real letter. And I asked them, what do you think I should do? Painted the picture for them. What do you think I should do? Knowing me as you do, would you pray about this and give me your best wisdom? And all 10 to the person wrote me back and said, I think God wants you to go to Texas. I'm so glad I did that, not for the sake of convincing my wife, but because it gave me a peace and an assurance that, yeah, God really was in this. It wasn't just a pipe dream. It wasn't just a whim. No, good and godly men believed it. So what is our proper response? Point 10, wrapping it up. When we do hear the voice of God, trust and obey. First, we must believe it. Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. God's not going to talk to us for very long if our approach is to say, okay, Lord, I'm leaning in. Tell me what to do. And he uses everything at his disposal to tell us what to do or who we are. And then we back off and say, well, I don't know. I'm just not, I ought to do something else. There's going to come a time where God finally says, well, okay, apparently you know what's best. So have at it. We've got to trust, and then we've got to obey. We've got to act upon what we've heard. I had all the evidence in the world that I needed that God was calling us to move to Texas, but, you know, it wasn't worth a hill of beans until we rented a U-Haul and hired a moving company and loaded up every single thing we had and made the 1,000-mile drive from Monroe, Georgia to Spring, Texas. That's when things began to happen. I am sure several of you here are familiar with the hymn, Trust and Obey. For there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Those are beautiful words. Those are true words. I'm looking forward to making this journey with you. And I'm looking forward to hearing what God has to say to me and what God has to say to you. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for being a speaking, communicating God who never leaves us to our own devices, who is always ready to impart to us grace upon grace, mercy, compassion, instruction, Lord, give us ears to hear, hearts that are eager to lean into you and know what you have to say about us and what it is you're ready to do in and through us. We receive it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Thank you for your kind attention.